It's a difficult weekend. We still have a team that are trying to organize safe passage for people from Mariupol, and this is ongoing. And that's just like can't overstate the importance of this operation and how crucial it is that it can happen. And at the same time here in Kyiv, our team has visited Irpin for the first time, the town of about 60,000 inhabitants that is almost completely deserted, with only about estimated 3,000 people still left there. But those who are left are the most vulnerable. We've seen elderly people, people with limited mobility, homeless people, and we carried out the first trip. We delivered some food and are going back tomorrow and after tomorrow to bring more and also go to other places like Bucha that have been affected by fighting and where humanitarian situation is dire right now.
We've been hearing some really quite horrific reports out of the town you just mentioned, Bukan, of bodies being found, of the area being heavily mined. Just talk us through a little bit of what exactly you witnessed when you went out to deliver aid.
We went to Irpin. For now, we haven't yet been to Bucha, but it's a priority to get there as soon as possible. So we are planning to go there in the next couple of days. The situation in Irpin is indeed catastrophic. We've seen horrendous amount of destruction. It is very difficult to get there safely because there's a lot of unexploded ordnance still on the road. So also extremely difficult for us to be responding to the situation because we cannot bring big trucks for now because the roads are just not safe enough. We are trying to do the back and forth to bring to people the essentials that they need with the Land Cruisers, with the 4x4s. When we ask people what they need, the first thing they mentioned is water. Then they said that they need bread and generators to be able to charge their phone. So it's water, bread, and a little bit of electricity to stay connected to the loved ones. So this is like, you can just imagine, these are really the basics of the basics. So I think that gives you a good idea of what the humanitarian situation is like. We've been to people's houses where I saw an elderly man dying alone in a house, dark, without electricity, without heating, without running water. Some of the images that we've saw there are just inhumane. And it's very difficult, as you mentioned, the security situation is extremely volatile, a lot of unexploded ordnance, very difficult to get there and to bring supplies, to organize logistics with roads heavily contaminated. And we're doing the best we can to bring the essential supplies there safely.
It really does sound like a desperate situation and horrific. We're hearing that Russian troops have withdrawn from those areas that you're now able to access. The man that you said you met, did he survive?
He's a very elderly, he's an old man, so he's in a critical condition, but he refuses to leave. And that is something that we see very often, that elderly, they just don't want to leave their homes, they want to die in their beds, and this is a choice that they make. He was in a difficult medical condition. He didn't want to leave. Our doctor provided first aid and left some painkillers with him, so to try to alleviate the suffering.
How does it make you feel? You're Ukrainian, seeing this in your own country and trying to help. How does it make you feel?
I think it doesn't matter what country you see too. I think before being Ukrainian or British or French or Russian, we are all first and foremost, we are human beings. And as a human being, seeing this amount of desolation, this amount of destruction, and this amount of sheer human suffering is just heartbreaking. It is extremely painful, but we just need to keep going and try to preserve space for humanity and for, I think, like what we do, the humanitarian response. Yes, it is important to bring water. It is important to bring food. It is important to give people electricity so they can charge their phones. But it's also what is the most important for me in what we're doing is to continue fighting to preserve humanity in this war, because that's what the international humanitarian law is all about. That's what the Geneva Conventions is all about. And that's what the International Cross is all about. We are there to remind people that there is a space for humanity, even in the most horrible of wars.
Let's just talk a little bit about Mariupol, because ever since the heavy bombardment of the southern port city of Mariupol started, there have been attempts to open up these humanitarian corridors. And I recall myself a couple of weekends ago, probably just after the start of the wide-scale invasion of Ukraine by Russia, that we were reporting that people were going to be evacuated out of Mariupol, but it didn't happen. And time again, you've attempted. What is the difficulty and why is it proving so difficult?
We continue trying and we speak to both sides and just insist and insist, and we will continue insisting that it is not a choice. It is their obligation under the international humanitarian law to make sure that people, that civilians who are in the city, that they can receive life-saving humanitarian assistance, that people who wish to leave, that they must be able to do so safely. And yes, indeed, there's been many attempts and unfortunately with no success, because for us as a neutral intermediary in our role, we can facilitate, but we only can facilitate the safe passages, and we can only bring humanitarian assistance if there is an agreement on both sides, and not just announcements, because there's been a lot of public communication that were being made about this situation, but we need very concrete and very precise and very practical agreement that will be respected. And unfortunately, this is not something that has happened until now.
And the situation at the moment, you're still attempting those evacuations. What update can you give us as we speak now?
Our team is on the way and they will try to facilitate the passage. And unfortunately, since this is an ongoing operation, there's very little that I can share right now. But the thing that I can share is that yes, we are trying and we will continue trying until there are still civilians in Mariupol, and we will not give up.
And I know you can't give us any details, but just so people can understand, is it a case that there are Russian checkpoints or that there is constant shelling? What's the security risks that you face?
Well, as I said, it's an ongoing operation. So unfortunately, I just can't share many details about it right now, except that, yes, it is a very difficult and volatile environment. And what we have been facing over and over again, that despite the public announcements, when things come to practice on the ground, in the field, there has been lack of conditions, lack of concrete agreements that would be respected for us to be able to conduct this operation safely. But again, this is an obligation for both sides under the international humanitarian law to do everything possible for people to receive aid and for people who wish to leave to be able to do that. And people have been leaving. People have been so desperate that they basically have been trying just to take enormous risk to get out of the city to safety. But this is not the way that this should be happening. There must be a possibility for them to leave the city safely. And this is what we keep reminding on both sides. And this is what we keep trying to organize.
I just want to touch on one thing here about misinformation, because the ICRC have faced a lot of misinformation recently online, where people have been claiming that you have been evacuating people into Russia. What is your response to those claims?
Well, my first response is that those claims are false, and that continue repeating those claims and spreading this misinformation is just extremely dangerous, because our teams, but also the volunteers from the Ukrainian Red Cross, they go to the field every single day. Every single day we cross numerous checkpoints, we approach front lines, and we are already doing something that is dangerous. And by spreading these false allegations and this misinformation, just making it so much worse. And also for the morale, because when you spend all day, you know, trying to like navigate between among this unexploded ordnance of war, and then you come back in the evening and you open social media and you see this groundless false accusation and like people trolling you, basically, like for morale. And like, I think it's very difficult for all of us right now, personally and professionally. And this campaign is just making it so much worse.
Clearly, the job that you do because you want to help. You talked about the personal and the professional there. Some of the reports that we've heard have said there have been up to 300 bodies found in a mass grave. What do you know about that? And what was your initial reaction to that?
Well, just like everybody else, I opened the news in the morning and I saw the reports, and the photographs that we see online, there are absolutely horrendous. And again, we're all human beings, and I think as like there cannot be any other reaction or any like from a human being when you see people, so many people who have died. We have not yet been able to reach Bucha, but it's definitely a priority for us, and we will do this in the coming days to assess the situation, to see if there are civilians, see how we can help, but also to listen to people, because documenting violations of the international humanitarian law is at the core of the ICRC mandate. And that's what we've been doing for the past 8 years during our presence in Ukraine. That's what we do in all the other countries where there's still armed conflicts going on. And that's what we continue to do. That's what I can say. But yes, the reports are extremely worrying.
So you will be trying to verify those reports in the coming days. Just one final question to you. You're from Odessa, I understand.
Yes, that's correct.
Do you still have family there? Have you been able to stay in contact with them? You know, how do you feel about what's going on there?
Yes, all my family is in Odessa. The majority of my friends are now refugees, so they have left. There's some who are still there. And it's been a very busy time, but I try to speak to them as much as I can. And I think in this situation, the only thing that we can do to each other is just support each other as much as we can, and just try to preserve humanity and kindness on human level, also on professional level. And yeah, just support each other and be kind to each other. That's the only thing that everybody has been trying to do just to go through this situation.
Thank you very much for talking to me and for giving us an update. You're welcome.